Well, thank you so much for coming.
Set this so that it doesn't turn off on me.
You know, she's the smartest person on the planet.
I'm excited.
How are you, my friend?
How are you?
Hey Richard, here's your
name.
Like,
NEOC is
a pretty small agency.
We
all wear a lot of
masks. Dean Davis, how are you, sir? If you'd have told us this 40 years ago, we'd have
laughed.
Hey, nice to meet you.
Welcome back, everyone, for the panel, the Georgia Open Records Act at 65, Challenges and Opportunities, Both New and Old. This is going to run from noon to 1 p.m. My name again is Jonathan Peters. I'm the chair of the Department of Journalism at the University of Georgia. I teach and research media law there, and I'm also the president of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. The Open Records Act declares a presumption that records must be disclosed without delay, that exceptions must be interpreted narrowly, and that public policy strongly favors government transparency because of its importance to a free and democratic society. As the late Charles Welkner, former Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Georgia, once wrote, public men and women, above all others, must be of good faith. Neither facile excuse nor clever dissimulation can serve in the stead of duty faithfully performed. Because public men and women are amenable at all times to the people, they must conduct the public's business out in the open. To what extent, though, is the Open Records Act fulfilling that promise? What does it do well? What are its persistent failings and sources of frustration? What are the major issues now arising under it? What would it take to make the act a model for how public information is gathered and shared in the 21st century? To help us try to answer these and other questions, we're joined by five panelists with deep experience and expertise who've engaged with the Georgia Open Records Act and with other such acts around the country in different roles as a lawyer, journalist, government relations professional, and academic. Carrie Teagarden is reporter and member of the investigative team at the Atlanta Journal and Constitution. She was a lead reporter on the award-winning Unprotected series, which prompted Georgia to reform its requirements for senior care homes in 2020. She was also a lead reporter on the Doctors and Sex Abuse National Investigation that was a Pulitzer finalist. And otherwise, she has written extensively about healthcare, unfair business practices, and the criminal justice system. Charles Davis is dean of the Grady College of Journalism and Mass Communication at the University of Georgia. And before entering the academy, he worked 10 years as a journalist for newspapers, magazines, and news services in Georgia and Florida. As a scholar, his work focuses on government transparency, including public records and meetings laws, and he served for 5 years as executive director of the National Freedom of Information Coalition. He is also co-author of the book, The Art of Access, Practical Strategies for Acquiring Public Records. Joy Ramsing is a lawyer whose practice focuses on transparent government issues and appellate litigation. She has counseled news organizations, businesses, government entities, and individuals. Previously, she worked at a firm in Philadelphia handling transparency issues, and she served as an appellate counsel to the Pennsylvania Office of Open Records, where she issued hundreds of binding legal opinions in public record appeals. Joy is also a member of the Board of Directors and Legal Committee of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. Allison Vale is a legal fellow at the First Amendment Clinic at the University of Georgia, where she litigates cases involving freedom of speech, press, assembly, and petition. Vale regularly counsels journalists and members of the public at news gathering and government transparency issues, including access under the Georgia Open Records Act and Open Meetings Act. Over the past year, she has studied the history of public records law in Georgia and is currently preparing an article exploring that history. And finally, John Burton is Managing Director of State Government Relations at RELEX, the parent company of LexisNexis. He has worked as a lobbyist in various capacities since 1999, and before that, he was a practicing attorney in Atlanta, specializing in civil and appellate litigation. His political work includes service as an aide to the Judiciary Committee of the Georgia House of Representatives and service on the Washington staff of U.S. Senator Sam Nunn. John also serves on the Board of Directors of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. Now, against that background, let's get into some discussion here, and I'd like to begin with Allison. You've been studying the history of the Georgia Open Records Act. What are some of the most interesting things that you have learned so far?
Yes, so I know this panel is called the Georgia Open Records Act of 65, but I'd like to dive into a little bit deeper history for just a moment, because I think it's really interesting how old issues have become new with the digital era. I think we're really concerned about privacy right now, but it's not that new. So public records, the concept of public records has been around in Georgia since the beginning of the state. Our first constitution of the state of Georgia in 1777 actually mentions public records. It provides for returning public records to the counties to which they belong. It's referring to just transferring the public records that were for safekeeping during the war. We had public records since the beginning. Land records are some of our earliest public records. And we had a statutory right of access since 1831, actually. In 1831, we had a statute that provided a right for the public to access county financial records during office hours. And so I think that's really the beginning of the Open Records Act. I would like to talk about a case from the Georgia Supreme Court in 1874. This was a case that involved property records. Someone wanted to compile property records for commercial purposes, and I think it's a good example of how old arguments have become new again. So in this case, the court was really concerned about the privacy interests of the people whose addresses would be revealed if we were allowed to make property plats a public commercial item. And the court says, and I quote, and this is in 1874, to put the substance of these records into print, to be sold and put into the hands of anyone who may chance to buy or borrow is an extension of this publicity beyond the necessities which make the record justifiable, and is a perversion of the object sought by the requirement to record. So we had the court in 1874 really concerned about making copies of public records, and I think that's a really interesting debate that was happening all the way back then. And then jumping forward to the Open Records Act that was passed in 1959, the original version of the Open Records Act just provided a right for the public to inspect the records, and so it was really designed around you going into a room physically and inspecting these records in person, having someone supervise you to look at them. And it wasn't until 1988 that the act became, that language was incorporated to create this right to like get copies from the government. And so now we have this system where the government is really making the copies for you. You're not really going in person to see the records anymore. The government is redacting them, checking them for redactions. It's become very expensive to get records. And that started in 1988. The same language that John quoted earlier about the exceptions being narrowly interpreted was also introduced in 1988. And that also kind of started this system where we have a very long Open Records Act now. We have, I think there's like 55 exceptions in the Open Records Act itself, and then there's a lot more outside of the statute. So we have this system where we have this very narrowly interpreted Open Records Act now with a lot of exceptions in it that are being administered. And so that's just like a little brief history. We'll get into a little bit more hopefully as we go, but I think that's an interesting debate about privacy that started really early on in the Georgia public records space.
Terrific, thank you, Allison. Carrie, against that historical background, I'd love for you to tell us how you have used the Open Records Act in your reporting. And so I'm thinking, for example, in your series on the state prison system last year.
Yes, I wrote almost all of last year about the prison system, and that covered fascinating stories, including a guy who figured out how to steal $11 million from the Charles Schwab account of the director of Crazy Rich Asians without ever leaving his prison cell. That was just one of the many fascinating things we got into. I would say it's a battle every day to get information from the Georgia Department of Corrections, like many agencies and state government. In our last installment of this series, we actually wrote a story about that, the difficulties, growing difficulties of getting that. And the lead image, it'll be hard to see this, but what this is was the picture that ran with this story, which is a response to an open records request. It's a bunch of pages of a document, most of which are completely redacted. They're just black pages of no information. We find that it's been more and more difficult to get basic records from them. And this is an example of why it's hard to find out what's going on. We used to get, they have video cameras throughout the prison system. We used to be able to get those records to really show what happened during like a violent attack, a fight, a knifing, a correctional officer beating someone up. And they started to refuse to release that information. And in fact, they actually, you know, had a big fight with the U.S. Department of Justice, which has a lawsuit, investigation ongoing, fought the attempts from them to get records, and it went on in federal court for quite a while. So we are able to get death records, incident reports, but oftentimes we have to use back doors, go to other agencies to get their own records from them to find out about what really happened and to really get the stories of about the correctional officers who brought up all sorts of contraband that enabled crimes to spill out in the community. There are massive drug and crime rings that run inside the prisons. But in order to get those records, again, we often had to go outside of Georgia Department of Corrections. We just had a story that ran recently about a guy who died in a fire in his cell, which the correctional officer saw the guy starting the fire, and it went on for hours. The only way we found out what really happened was through a lawsuit. And so we love working with attorneys. I love attorneys. So I would say it's essential that we use the Open Records Act. We use it all the time, but it's a constant battle to get the records that we're entitled to. And I say that as someone who has worked with some of the best attorneys in this industry, Peter and Tom, I mean, they're incredible. We still have to battle every day to expose what's happening in our state government.
Carrie, a quick follow-up question for you. Do you have a sense of why it's gotten more difficult to get records out of the Department of Corrections? What has changed?
It's not just the Department of Corrections, it's every agency. I'll just give two quick examples. The Georgia Bureau of Investigation used to be the best agency. If you would call, they had a spokesman, get them on the phone, they would give it to you immediately. I have an email right here from them talking about how we currently are experiencing an estimated backlog of 6 to 8 weeks in completing requests. Any basic request, 6 to 8 weeks. I mean, they're supposed to give it to you in 3 days. These are basic records. That's completely unacceptable and not what we've experienced throughout our history. As I've been a journalist here for 30 years. And so it's throughout government that it's just not a priority, and the AG's office doesn't really enforce on our behalf as often. I would also say that the cost, there are a lot of slow walking, and also in electronic requests, the cost and just delays in doing things like redacting are serious. And this is just a request from the last couple weeks in our newsroom. Someone on our team requested a big data set from a big city government in Atlanta. You might be able to guess who it is. The estimate for the request, the cost, $13 million. And the time it was going to take to fulfill the request is 183 years. So that's definitely past my deadline of the filing. But that's really not okay to respond in that way.
So in a few minutes, we're going to pass the collection hat in support of that request. So Joy, I'd like to go to you now. What areas of the Georgia Open Records Act do you think are particularly problematic, and how might those problems be addressed?
Well, since we're talking about it, let's stay on the issue of fees, right? And I really struggle with this because as an attorney, if I sent my client a $13 million bill and said, trust me, I've done this in the most economical way possible. I used the lowest paid people on my staff to fulfill as much of this work as I could, but I'm not gonna give you a time estimate, I'm not gonna give you a time record, I'm not gonna tell you their names or their job descriptions or how much time it took them to do this work. And you're just gonna have to trust me, and if you don't like it, you can sue me. If I said that to an individual, I think that regulatory authorities would be kind of upset at how I'm treating, you know, the clients. And I think that the problem with the fee provisions as they are right now is that it's always a question of fact, right? What is a reasonable fee? Or, you know, what is the most economical way to do this? And so when people come to me and they want to challenge the fee, then I have to explain to them that we may have to go through the discovery process to determine whether or not this fee is reasonable, although sometimes on its face it's unreasonable. But you know, then you have to go through the discovery process, and at that point you may have spent more in litigation than you have for actually paying the fee. So, I'm relatively new to the Georgia legal landscape, so I can't really bring a historical perspective. But coming from a couple of other states where I do this work, I can bring a comparative perspective. And one of the things, a couple of solutions that I might see is that, first of all, there are some states that just really, they get rid of the whole search, retrieval, you know, we're gonna spend all this time, and they focus on flat fees for duplication costs per page, and for the agency being able to recoup any actual cost that they spend with third-party vendors. In the absence of that, perhaps an amendment to the law that would allow, or would require rather, an agency to provide a more of a detailed breakdown. Because that at least gives the requester a point from which they can challenge. Now, a lot of requesters, some agencies already provide that. A lot of requesters will create it themselves by asking follow-up questions. Who's doing the work? What's their job position? What's their hourly? And then they do the math. And then from that point, they can say, well, this doesn't add up. One of the things that I try to do just recently, working on a settlement, as part of the settlement, the agency is now required to post a fee schedule online. Well, that's very helpful because they're not going to post an unreasonable fee schedule. And now from this point forward, requesters can check their, you know, their estimate against the fee schedule. So that's one another way that we might be able to address this issue. I'm sure that some of the folks sitting in this room who have been dealing with this issue in Georgia longer than I have would probably have even better ideas about how to combat that. But right now, this sort of murky question of fact around fees is always going to be an access to justice block for any citizen or, you know, media organization or even a large corporation who wants to bring a suit to get public records.
And the other thing I kind of appreciate about this response from the unnamed agency in Kerry's case is that, you know, back in medieval times, of course, it was a multi-generational project that you would build a cathedral. And so I kind of appreciate that we now have a multi-generational approach to fulfilling records requests. It's not ideal. So Charles, I want to widen the lens for a moment and ask a more general question. Over your career, you have filed and helped others file hundreds and hundreds of open records requests all over the country. What have you learned from those experiences?
Many painful lessons, but some that I think are sort of universal, probably. And whenever I get a chance to talk about public records and preach a little bit about how to, I guess, I start with the fact that when I'm dealing with entities that are struggling to wrestle records from public agencies, and I sort of reverse engineer the request, what I typically get to is a vague or poorly written request that wasn't very well thought out. So rule number one, I would say, do your homework. A lot of the work in retrieving public records comes from the front end, not the back end. I talk a little bit, Dave and I talk in the book about a little bit about interviewing documents. Which makes us sound a little daffy, but what I mean by that is if you know the document that you seek, or you have a good idea of the document you seek, spend some time literally visualizing in your mind what that document might look like. Does it have a proper name? Does it have a number? Numbers are gold. If it's form 98-367, then you can put that in the request. It's much more specific, right? So, I think lesson number one really is blocking and tackling, but it's get to know the record before you request it. It's not at all out of line to call a public official or a public agency and have a conversation about the request. Now, some of the work Kerry's doing, you can't really do that, right? I understand, like, practically, like, I'll be doing an investigation and I need these records. That doesn't exactly work. But for a lot of people, day-to-day FOI work, it works well to have sort of a pre-conversation about the request. I've asked people many times, how much is too much? Do we need to restrict the search terms? Do we need to restrict the search dates? Do you have a blank form of the document that you seek? That's gold if you do, appended to the request. So some of that stuff is just basic stuff, but it works really well.
Now, what about navigating a denial? So somebody comes back to you, and for whatever reason, the exemption given, what do you think is the best practice for trying to navigate one?
There's more than one approach, and I usually try to sort of activate two or three simultaneously. One of them, and this is a really important point for you public records users, public records requesters, the public record law is not the ceiling, it's the floor. It's the legal minimum that the agency must do, mandated by law, right? Politics, common sense, sometimes dictate that they do much more. So first of all, figure out the political landscape that you're in, what the nature of the request is, and see if you can cajole them into releasing the records. I would say over the course of, I don't even know, hundreds and hundreds of FOI requests, many times I've been able to extract records that were either not part of the original request or that exceeded the original request by calling on the sort of good politics involved in releasing information to the public. So don't give up. Don't ever give up. Challenge everything. make them show you in the law. That's the most basic thing. One of the things that we run into all the time in this line of work is exemptions being claimed that don't fit the records. Seriously, across my career, I've seen it many times, exemptions being created out of whole cloth. So make sure you do your legal homework. Peter and Dave can help with that, but you know, you reach out and say, does this exemption actually exist? Or does it exist as written? Sometimes they'll rewrite them.
Sure. John, I'd like to go to you now. Maintaining that wide lens, there are fairly consistent legislative and other efforts to limit to, access to open records year over year, but the policy motivations for them are often dynamic and they change over time. Could you give us any context about how those efforts have changed?
Sure, glad to. I think the old saying that all politics is local, it pretty much remains true when you start talking about issues of open records and First Amendment issues. 99% of the time when you see legislation filed at a particular state level, it is truly trying to solve a problem at the local state level, or in some instances, hide a problem at the local state level. Just for entertainment value, last week we were working on a bill in a state that I won't mention, that they were seeking to prohibit traffic violations from extending beyond the borders of the state. Well, when we dug in a little further, we found out that the sponsor was the owner of an interstate trucking company. And so he wanted to make sure that any traffic violations that committed in that state weren't going into other states. So those are just kind of some of the kind of things you see. But, as Carrie and Joy have kind of talked about, just because they're local problems doesn't mean they're immune from larger geopolitical issues. So large geopolitical, large global events, large-scale domestic events absolutely do impact how states react to their open records kind of capabilities. And as Jonathan has reminded me so painfully that I've been doing this since 1999, there have absolutely been definite periods of time that have been influenced by global events that have impacted open records. The first I can identify for you is clearly, obviously, 9/11. It was truly a very fascinating case study to watch what the individual states did on an open records front post 9/11. Obviously, it was most pronounced in the Northeast Corridor on the Eastern Seaboard Coast, but it certainly had its impact across the entire United States. And it was just a fascinating case study to watch that some states said, okay, in the interest of national defense and protecting its domestic security, domestic terrorism, we're going to throw everything open. Everything's open. Everything's public records. It all needs to be out there so we can all join together and fight this terrorist capability. Other states took the exact opposite approach. They said, nope, we're shutting down everything. Everything needs to be shut down, taken out of the public purview, so terrorists, foreign governments can't get access to information that they may need to do to conduct terrorist activities. So it was just really a fascinating study to see that some states went open door, some states shut the door. Another trend that we saw emerge in the mid-2000s really emanated from a law that was originally passed in the state of California. All of you are now familiar with California. It was the first state to pass what we call data breach security legislation. That is, if you're a company or a business and you're hacked from the outside or somebody gets into your data, you have to do customer notifications and what have you. Well, it was very interesting that at that point in time, even though ironically the California law did not apply to government agencies, you saw government agencies still saying, okay, in the interest of preventing ID theft, we're going to start shutting off records, we're going to start shutting off access to certain information within records. And so even though all these concerns were later kind of mitigated by a Javelin study that said there's no evidence whatsoever that open records or public records leads to wide-scale identity theft, you still have government agencies seeking to close access to records and information within records in the interest of identity theft. So next, fast forward to now 2018. Once again, California on the front end of the trend. They were the very first state to pass an omnibus consumer privacy act called the California Consumer Privacy Act. Again, ironically, did not apply to government agencies. But yet government agencies seized on the trend to say, okay, in the interest of consumer privacy, we're going to start closing out records, we're going to start prohibiting access to certain data within government records, all in the interest of privacy. We do have a new emerging trend that I'm going to stop here. I'm going to hold on to that because I think we're going to get into that later in the discussion.
Okay. Thank you, John. Allison's zeroing in again on Georgia. Last year, there were legislative efforts to expand the Open Records Act's privacy exemption for public employees. Could you tell us a little bit about that effort and then give us some history on the Open Records Act's privacy exemptions?
Yes. So kind of related to what John was just saying, in Georgia, we had in the late 90s and the 2000s, there were a few exceptions added for privacy. Your social security number actually wasn't protected in Georgia until 2001, which I think is really interesting. Your social security number was public until 2001. It used to be on your driver's license. It was same as your driver's license number. Sorry, can you hear me okay? Okay. So we currently have two main privacy exceptions in the Georgia Open Records Act. We have one exception for the general public, your social security number, your, I think it's your email, and your personal unlisted phone number is protected. And then public officials have sort of an extra layer of protection. If the record identifies them as a public official, then their home address can be redacted from that record. That structure really comes from the 2012 amendments. In 2012, there was a comprehensive reform to the Open Records Act, really cleaned it up. And so that kind of structure comes from the 2012 amendments. Prior to that, public officials had a few different exceptions that weren't limited to records that identified them as public officials. And so in like 1998, there was some protection for law enforcement and judges and a few others. And then over the years, there were like a few other public officials who were added to that, but it didn't even cover all public officials. And then we have the exception for everyone else gets added in 2001 for your social security number and that kind of stuff. And so what happened last year is that there were some efforts to add more protection for the home addresses of public officials, law enforcement, judges, and that was going to apply regardless of whether the record identifies you as a public official. So you would have more protection than the general public has over your address. Your address is accessible in a lot of ways. You can request a list of the voter. You can request the entire voter registration list, so you can get copies of everyone's addresses that way, unless they're protected under. There's some protections for domestic violence survivors. But other than that, you can get your address that way. You can also get it through your property records. If you own property, you can get your address that way. And then your address might appear in a lot of other records that are held by the government. A lot of databases your address might be in. So it's a lot of work to redact your address from those records. And so last year there were some proposals on the table to protect public officials' addresses in all of those records, which would have been hard to administer. And so what ended up passing last year was a new provision of the Open Records Act that allows certain public officials, including law enforcement, I think judges, not all public officials, but some, to ask that their address be removed from things that are publicly posted on local government's websites. So it doesn't actually apply to the Open Records Act at all, doesn't require any extra redaction. But it does apply to things that are posted publicly online. And so that's kind of the framework for these new exemptions. And I think, yeah.
Allison, a follow-up question for you. It's about how we define a public official under the Open Records Act. So of course on this panel, we've got, you know, legal fellow at the University of Georgia, we have a dean at the University of Georgia, department chair at the University of Georgia. Do we count? Are we public officials under the Open Records Act?
So when I say public officials, that's not what appears in the actual act. It lists, I think that exemption 21 right now lists just public officials, so I think we would all count under that if we're identified on the record as a public official. So if it said like Allison Biley working at the University of Georgia, this is her address, that would probably be redactable. But the new exemption, it's 50-1878, that exemption for new public officials, that is specifically law enforcement, judges, and a few other, I think, listed there. It doesn't like use the phrase public employees.
And then that one, of course, was originally conceived much more broadly than that, and it was narrowed through legislative discussions and compromises. So let's see, Carrie, going back to you, you've covered a little bit of this already, kind of in the narrow context of the Department of Corrections, for example. You've been a reporter at the agency for more than 30 years. What are some of the key changes that you have seen in terms of your practical ability to get access to the records that you need to do your reporting?
I think one of the big changes, Charles talked about this, like we used to be able to call up an agency and say, tell us about your records. So we would know how to write a good request and avoid someone telling us it was going to take 183 years or whatever it was to produce the records. To find out about what do you guys have? What do the forms look like? And it's very hard to get people on the phone now who will sort of engage with you just about their own records. I've spent many years battling with the Georgia Department of Community Health. They have a huge impact on all of our lives. And they won't even do interviews. This is sort of an insight into this. I spent about a year writing about access to mental health services for children and teens. I think we all understand we're in a crisis point with that. We have record numbers of kids dying through suicide. And there is a huge problem with kids getting access to services. This is an agency that provides the health care through Medicaid for about half the kids in Georgia. So I had a lot of battles with them related to their records. Some of their records weren't accurate, things that they were sending to the General Assembly saying, oh, we only turned down 100 kids for denial of services. Well, I actually had records from their own agency showing they had thousands of denials. And the kids in foster care we knew were getting denied for services. I asked the head of this agency just for an interview, what are you guys doing to help children and teens in Georgia get access to care? They denied any requests just for an interview about this, and it's a series we've been reporting for years. They invited me to submit maybe 3 to 4 questions, which I did, which were never answered. So when you have an agency that won't even engage with you on one of the most critical things going on in our society right now, one of the biggest problems that we have, and won't even talk about what they're doing, that is a real problem, because you never get to what are you building into your contracts, what kind of data are you collecting to show us the denials, how are you monitoring these the care management organizations, the HMOs that you brought in to administer your programs. What are their denial rates? Let's talk about getting the data. It's very frustrating. And I have a low bar for frustration. I'm very easily frustrated, like any good reporter. We just find everything is an outrage. As the mother of 2 teenagers, this is a very serious issue. University of Georgia is struggling with suicide cases just in the last few days. And so I think the biggest problem we have is it's very hard to walk into an agency's office, get them on the phone, and have them engage with you about what kind of records they even have. You used to walk into Vernon Keenan's office at the GBI. He would give you a piece of cake from a cake that his mother made. I'm sure many of you in this room have had Mrs. Keenan's cakes. Now you don't even get someone on the phone. They send you to their open records portal and tell you it'll be 6 weeks. So I think that is, I would say, just the inability to just find out what's there and engage and have a agency that is focused on providing public information is, I think, one of the biggest problems that we face. And then some of these exemptions, I think, are a problem too, that they'll pass an exemption for a certain reason and then abuse the exemption. The Kirby rule, I think, is what we call it. UGA passed a rule to protect their recruiting process, right? It gives more time for you guys are more familiar with this than I am. We feel it's now been made it hard for us to get records about very tragic accidents that occurred. Everybody knows about it. And the Kirby rule is supposed to, help them get better recruits. Actually, it helps them not provide information. Department of Corrections has an exemption related to state secrets around their security so that maybe the gangs can't get information about exact setups of the various prisons. they're using that now to really shield themselves from providing the kind of information that would kind of show the failures of their government. And we've seen that it's kind of going in the other way, right? We saw that in the past when legislators realized that some of these exemptions were actually protecting agencies, they would, you know, pass laws to make it easier to get records. And now we see some of that going in the other way. And so that's concerning to us. And if we don't have as lawmakers that and the Attorney General's office that transparency is good, then that's, you know, helping it, making it very hard for us to do their jobs and standing in the way of government really being held accountable.
Joy, if we look for a moment at the other side of the page, so to speak, you know, what would you say is the most underrated aspect of the Georgia Open Records Act?
So something that sort of took me by surprise when I began to familiarize myself with the Open Records Act, because I know there are a lot of privacy exemptions and concerns that come up, and they come up in the context of talking about exemptions, right? But I've worked in jurisdictions where there's actually a constitutional, a state constitutional right to privacy. And that's really a death knell to a lot of different public records, because, you know, in those jurisdictions, Supreme Courts have held that, you know, home addresses, right? It's now no longer just, oops, you broke this exemption. Oh no, you violated somebody's constitutional rights. And don't think that doesn't get cited by agencies all the time. Well, we have to take, you know, we have to take all this extra time, we have to double check the redactions, we have to do all these things, because if not, we're gonna get sued for violating someone's constitutional right to privacy. One of the things that the Open Records Act does, it's 50-18-73C, and it basically says, if you provide access in good faith on reliance on the Open Records Act, then you're not going to be liable. And whenever I come into a gray area with an agency, I cite that to them, right? When we're going back and forth in a negotiation, I remind them, you're not going to be held liable if it involves some third party, if you're relying in good faith on the Open Records Act, you're on the side of the angels when you err on the side of disclosure. I promise you, if there was something in the act that said the opposite of that, they would be citing it to me, right? So that's something, whenever I send a request, I try to cite that to them. Right, you are not going to be liable. The intention of the act, the purpose of the act, is to further open government. If there's a gray area, first of all, you're supposed to go on my side because of presumption. But second of all, if you do err on the side of disclosure, as long as there's a good faith argument for that, you're not liable. Georgia is unique in that aspect. We need to use that provision as best we can.
Allison, what do you, the AG's mediation program has been under some scrutiny in recent months. How did the AG mediation program originally come about, and how has it evolved over time? And why are we hearing about it now?
Sure. So the AG mediation program originated in 1998, there was a provision added to the Open Records Act that allowed the Attorney General to initiate civil and criminal prosecution under the act. And so the AG then created the mediation program, and that's all that the law says about that program. It doesn't require them to have that program, it doesn't require them to do anything. And so that program has been under increasing scrutiny recently because they just lost one of their main attorneys, Jennifer Colangelo. And so now I think that was 50% of their attorneys in that program. I'm not sure how many there are, but I think that there's two and now there's one. And so the mediation program has, because they set their own parameters, they have decided not to mediate disputes about exemptions. They're on the record about that. They're also on the record about refusing to mediate with other state agencies. So they only mediate with local governments because the AG mediation program, well, the Attorney General will end up being on the defense side if you sue a state agency for open records violations. And so they will not mediate disputes with that state agency. And so the combination of those two makes the program of limited import, because you can't get them to review an exemption. So the only way, if you think that an exemption does not apply, the only way that you can really challenge that, other than acting nicely, is to sue. And so that's a really expensive thing to do, to get a court to do in-camera review to see if the exemption actually applies. So the AG mediation program won't do that. And that is a little bit unique. There's a few other states that do have like more of an ombudsman type of mediation program. Georgia and Florida both have like voluntary AG mediation programs. And so that program, I do want to give a couple of stats about it, because I think that they're interesting stats. In terms of the Open Records Act, the AG has only initiated a criminal prosecution one time. Under the Act, even though there's been criminal penalties in that law since 1982, there's only ever been one criminal prosecution, and that was in 2017 of a City of Atlanta employee. There were text messages in that case that made it particularly a strong criminal case. And then there's only been, as far as I'm aware, I searched yesterday to make sure I wasn't missing any, I think there's only ever been one civil prosecution by the Attorney General's office. That was in 2006. It was the Center of Atlantic Progress versus Baker, and I'm looking at one of the attorneys who was on that case as well. I think that that's the only one. So they've only done two litigations, as far as I know, under the Open Records Act. So the Attorney General's office is not super active in open records in open records compliance.
Now, Joy, I want to return to you for just a moment. I know that you and I discussed this issue before. I know you've got some thoughts. Would you like to add any of them to the discussion here?
Yeah, I think I'll just say that, you know, inaction really isn't neutral. I just recently had a situation. I wasn't really going to talk about this, but here we are. I just recently had a situation where I was in a negotiation with another attorney and with a retired judge, and the agency brought up an interpretation of the law, and I said, that's incorrect. And everyone sort of agreed it was incorrect. And they said, well, we got a letter from the AG's office and we responded to them. We sent them back a letter outlining that this was our position, and they didn't tell us we were wrong. And even though, you know, in that negotiation, the attorney looking at me, they knew their interpretation was right or was wrong, and the court sort of we all knew this was questionable. They relied on that in action as an argument. Legally, as support. They saw that in action as support. Whether or not it was intended to be support by the Attorney General is a different question entirely, but they saw the lack of the response as an implicit sanctioning of their argument. And I think that is really illustrative of some of how, you know, it's not just a neutral position that you're taking when you're not actively enforcing the law. It is actually, you know, it's being interpreted, it's being utilized, even if that's not the intent, it's being utilized as a weapon against open government by council and by different agencies that choose to rely on that as some kind of stamp of approval.
Thank you. John, from your perspective, looking at this again nationally, what do you see as the biggest threat or issue that is currently impacting the openness of government records?
Yeah, and this is an easy answer, and I'm going. It's an excellent segue off comments that Allison and Carrie had previously detailed about the exemptions in the Georgia Open Records Act. It's purely one of opt-out, and it began roughly 2021. New Jersey passed a law entitled the Daniels Law. And the Daniels Law, as introduced and passed, was of the best policy and intentions. The situation that happened in New Jersey was an individual went to confront, I believe, a federal judge in New Jersey. She was not home, her son was home, and the individual shot and killed her son. So New Jersey passed a law, as well they should have, and the specific intent of the law was to prohibit the public posting of information about judges with the intent to harm or intimidate. And I think we can all agree that's sound public policy. Now, fast forward a little bit to late 2022, Congress was passing the National Defense Authorization Act. Late in the night, which is how sometimes these things tend to pass, a Daniels law was stuck in the National Defense Authorization Act. But it also included the opportunity for judges to completely opt out their information for public access. And so from this point forward, now you've got an onslaught of states who are falling in line to introduce legislation that allows public officials, whether it's judges, elected officials, agency employees and heads, to completely opt out of public records or redact their information from public records so that no one can get to it. And it's not just the elected official or the state employee, it's their spouse, their children, their extended family. So you can see the problems that this is going to create if we're allowing one class of employees or individuals to completely opt out of public records. To compound this, I know the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, my company and many others have been working to oppose a current activity now by the Uniform Law Commission, which is putting forth model legislation to do just this, to allow public officials and public employees to opt out of public records. And so, as you can see, it creates a myriad of problems. I mean, you have First Amendment considerations right off the top. There are issues of verification and authentication. How do you know that the John Doe who says he is who he is, and allow him to opt out of these public records? What about when these individuals are no longer in office, or they're no longer employed by the state? Does this right extend out? How do you reverse it? How do you call it back? What are the logistics for implementing this or enforcing this? Is it on the particular agency that they are employed by, or their agency that governs the judges, what have you? And how do the administrators do this? What about downstream effects in commerce? I think we all know that if an individual opts themselves out of public records, they're going to run into a myriad of problems downstream in commerce, whether it's getting through the airport security, on-site credit transactions, getting insurance, getting a home loan mortgage. You're going to create problems, and that they're not being educated that when they do this, that this is potentially going to happen. Look, we all know that there are bad actors in all walks of life. Lawyers, doctors, even lobbyists like me have been known to run afoul of the law. But, and I'm not going to butcher the Latin phrase, but if this trend is allowed to continue, you know, the question is, who will watch the watchmen? So this is a real and clear present danger right now in public records access, is just this firestorm of opt-out capabilities at the state level.
Thank you, John. Charles, going back to you, you're the co-author of the book, The Art of Access, A Practical Guide to Public Records. You mentioned the book earlier, so I'm going to violate the journalistic and legal rule against compound questions here. So one, what's the essence of the book? And then two, what is the most overlooked part of filing a successful public records request?
If you'll allow me just one aside, I wanted to follow up and Carrie's excellent point that agencies are acting with greater and greater impunity out there. I mean, this has been a multi-year trend. This isn't news to anybody who works with journalists for a living. But the actions of, what was that, the Department of Public Health? Community Health you were talking about. Just an agency that literally will not sit down for an interview, that will not answer questions. I don't think we're raising enough hell, to be honest. I think that it's incumbent upon journalistic institutions largely, not you, Carrie, the people you work for, need to not take that for an answer. I mean, I think whether it's a countdown clock on the front page of the AJC that every time you log on says it's been 12 days since the director of the Department of Community Health has responded to our questions, or if we publicize FOI denials, we don't do nearly enough of this. We're given, and I rail about this a lot, but journalists are given, like, you know, we buy barrel by the ink, let's use it. It's really frustrating that these things happen and we come to a conference and we all talk about it, and like, they don't respond, our requests were denied. The public doesn't know the half of this. We need to make this much more public. It needs to get painful for agencies to act with that kind of impunity. Okay, sermon over. To your question, the most important single thing I have learned over
a lifetime of playing around in this world and helping journalists get records, is that the best ones, the ones that are most successful, both journalistically and as requesters, go at the entire request, and then indeed, really their lives as journalists, with a sense of play. And by that I mean they make it fun. It's a game. You want information, they don't want to give it to you. If you don't engage in that back and forth with some sense of mirth, of good humor, then you will spend your life deeply frustrated. By contrast, if you spend it thinking of it kind of in game-like fashion, that they're trying to play keep away and you're trying to get it, it's a lot more fun. If you think about it, you're in the position of asking for things and retrieving them. My mentor in that whole sort of mindset was a guy named Mike McGraw at the Kansas City Star, long since deceased, a good friend. We worked together on a lot of stuff over the years, and Mike was the best I've ever seen. I'll just give you one anecdote that sort of sums him up. We were doing a bunch of requests, federal FOIA requests, for the USDA for a series that Mike ultimately won a Pulitzer Prize for, and he was particularly interested in some lab reports from one meat packing plant in Kansas. He made an FOI request that we tracked together for a year and a half, and he found the FOI officer in the USDA lab outside of Topeka, Kansas. His name was Bob, I can't remember his last name. But Mike, over the course of a year and a half, had a note to call Bob every Friday afternoon at about 1:30 in the afternoon, because he figured Bob would be around and not have a lot to do. And for a year and a half, every Friday, Mike McGraw called this guy and asked after the kids, wanted to know what he was gonna do this weekend. He tortured this man. But he did so in this delightfully funny way, to the point where they actually kind of expanded and they talked for 15, 20 minutes every time he called. And after about 18 months, one day Mike's phone rang and it was 1:30 on Friday and it was Bob. And Bob said, "I have your records." And that ultimately became kind of the cornerstone of that story in many ways. So I just think it's that. You're not going to persevere in a lot of these things if you don't go into it with the attitude that it's a game at the end of the day.
So set your calendar reminders now. So we've got about 8 minutes remaining. I'd like to open it up to audience Q&A. What questions do we have? And we'll see if Frank can hop around the room with a microphone. Any questions? Let's see. Frank, over to the left. It's Nydia.
Let's talk a little bit about the mental health aspect of dealing with trying to get open records out of these cases. I heard approach it with a sense of play, but people experience real harm from the denial of records. You know, people experience real harm from this system. It's definitely hard to approach it with a sense of play, especially if you're small media, you can't afford a lawyer. What are your advice for the mental health aspects for people who do not have lawyers who are dealing with this system?
That's a great question. I'm not saying that it's not frustrating. The process is deeply frustrating. I guess what I'm saying is you can either internalize that frustration or you can externalize that frustration. We're not doing enough externalizing of it, I don't think. We're carrying it around with us, which probably mental health-wise is not great. If we start publicly shaming, for lack of a better term, the officials that are treating us with such deep disrespect, I gotta think that's gonna make us feel better, at least get some of it out of us, right, if nothing else. But more importantly, I'm not saying that just to be vindictive. I'm saying it because if we turn the spotlight back on the people that are denying us access to information, and in some cases just mere sitting down and talking with us, I think it puts the focus on the right part, which are the people that are expanding the secrecy.
And I'll add to that, if you can't laugh at it, go to work. You know, I mean, anything, there are a lot of different options, you know, reach out, the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, you know, we do a lot of different trainings for the public, trainings for journalists and cities, sure, but also, you know, we would be willing to do a training. I have done, you know, pro bono trainings at local libraries, anything you can do, you know, to spread awareness. I mean, I always find that when I get frustrated, the only option I have is, yes, to stay as positive as possible, but also just to channel all of that into some kind of productive effort. And I think that GFAF is a great resource for that, because we have a group of folks who are trying to work on these things and acknowledging that there may not be a perfect solution, right, to the enforcement aspect or to the fees aspect or whatever. But the fact that we're here in the room today and we're putting our heads together to try to work towards solutions and better dialogue for these things, that encourages me personally. You know, so focusing on that is and channeling efforts toward that, I think, is helpful.
One other comment that I'll make here, you mentioned the challenge of not having a lawyer. And so I would be remiss here if I didn't mention the UGA First Amendment Clinic. You know, Allison, of course, is a legal fellow there. Claire Norrens, director of the clinic. Sam Hamilton, one of the legal fellows there. They are able often to provide counsel, sometimes litigation representation. There is a grant currently being administered by the clinic to provide representation to local news organizations around Georgia, independent journalists who otherwise can't afford counsel. So definitely keep them in mind, and like Joy mentioned, the Georgia First Amendment Foundation as well. You know, wherever we can help, we always try. Any other questions? Yes, Richard.
So I think everybody here knows I'm a huge advocate for open government and speak and actively work towards open government. But in my work and training with municipalities, we often hear from those municipalities, yes, this is great in principle, but where the rubber hits the road and we get 40 requests from what they would call a vexatious requester, we get buried. How does the panel respond to municipal organizations or government agencies who say, we're just getting abused here? What's the appropriate response? And how do we overcome that through the education of those officials?
I try to connect the two parties as much as I possibly can. And that frequently results in there being no productive outcome. Except that if they each understand to the extent that you can, and as Carrie mentioned, like a lot of times you can't get them on the phone, right? If people won't talk, they won't talk. But letting the two parties come kneecap to kneecap, sometimes the best way to do that is to go to court and end up in some kind of mandatory mediation situation where they are forced to come to the table. And at that point, they can air their grievances with one another.
I think that a lot of these, I hear that complaint as well, a lot of these vexatious requesters, a lot of time I feel like are requesting really basic records. They're requesting like the meeting minutes after the meeting, they want the agenda, they want the executive session affidavit, they want the budget. Those are really simple records that local governments can post online without having to wait for a request. So I think that local governments should really be spending a little bit more time trying to proactively respond to open records requests. You know, the city of Atlanta, if you look at their website, they have like everything from the meetings is online already. And so if you're getting a lot of requests, maybe consider being a little bit more proactive with those requests.
Any remaining question? We've got about 1 minute. No. Okay, well, let's see. Once again, thank you to all the panelists for sharing their expertise and experience with us, and thank you all for being here again. We appreciate it.
Next session in 10 minutes. Racketeering up next.
Yeah. 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 Ye
I was walking downtown and he said, "Loop them back." I was like, "There can't be more than one." That is amazing.
Daddy, just watch.
You may not know him. He names used to be another softball player too.
Oh yeah.
You play him?
Thank you very much for coming.
This was a delightful day.
Anytime you're doing this, you are in.
Thank you for that, because in the past I've always
been. Well, but it saves us and it makes a permanent record.
You have to heckle for that. So I thought
yeah, it was great. But you know what you said, it was one of the discussions you had.